My dear brothers, the night before he died, Jesus, our Master and Lord, washed the feet of his disciples as an example of true and loving service. Later, to ensure that such loving service was built into the very structure of the Church, the apostles chose 7 men filled with the Spirit and with wisdom, and laid hands on them and entrusted them with this duty. In the same way, you, my brothers, through the prayer of the Church and the laying on of hands, have been entrusted with this duty. Today, in the presence of me, your bishop, and God's holy people, are you ready to renew your own dedication to serve Christ as deacons in his Church?
I don't know if I chose to become a deacon or it chose me.
I had this feeling within me that I wanted to serve the Church.
At your ordination, you accepted the responsibilities of the diaconate out of love for the Lord Jesus and his Church. Are you resolved to unite yourselves more closely to Christ by trying to become more like him who came not to be served, but to serve?
He was running the course, said, "Did I think of becoming a deacon?" And I said no, and for 9 months I said no.
Well, I think in the Church we think very carefully about the notion of vocation. Vocation coming from a root word, vocare, to call. So my feeling is that I was called by God to assume this role, to enter into this vocation.
Are you resolved to be faithful ministers of the mysteries of God, to assist at the Eucharist and other liturgical services with sincere devotion?
In short, I became a deacon because it would allow me in some small way to repay Jesus for all that he's done for me.
And it was Good Shepherd Sunday, Vacation Sunday, and the question came up about the diaconate. And I thought to myself, not for me, too much of a checkered past, I think.
I don't think it's a case of why I chose it, it's why the Lord chose me. You know, our Lord called us and we answered his call.
Are you resolved to proclaim the gospel of Christ, whose herald you are, by believing the gospel you read, teaching what you believe, and practicing what you preach?
I think I was conned into it. Somebody told me that it was just a wee course that you had that helped the parish priest out. And I thought, oh, that's fine, I'll do that, because I was quite active in the parish in the first place. And when we went to the first propaduate weekend and they started talking about a 3-year course, I nearly died.
After a wee while, the idea sort of came up in my head again, and coincidentally there was an ordination in St Mary's in Coatbridge, and the parish priest took me to that. And it was really from, I think, that point on, I thought to myself, well, I think maybe I should at least try and see.
Are you resolved, in union with me, your bishop, to proclaim faithfully the kingdom of God by working for peace and unity, both within and beyond the Christian community, seeking always to ensure that the love of Christ is made visible in your actions?
In St Bartholomew's was a notice at the back of the church, the permanent diaconate, could it be for you? And I left it, the leaflet, and took it home and said to my wife, what does this entail?
But it kept on working on me, and eventually I took further information on it and applied to the diaconate course after that. When the call came again, I decided to go and investigate it and spoke to Father Miller and then my parish priest, and before I knew it, I was on the proper duty here.
But all the way through it, in moments of prayer, I would always ask, are you sure about this? No, me, somebody else. Are you sure you want me to be a deacon?
I followed the feelings that I had inside me to serve the Church. And as time went on, I believe that God gave me the answers as to why I became a deacon.
My dear brothers and sisters, pray for your deacons, that together with your priests, they may be faithful ministers of Christ the High Priest, who laid down his life for us and commanded us to love one another as he has loved us.
Lord Jesus, hear us and answer our prayers.
I'm the Roman Catholic chaplain here in Shorts Prison. Shorts Prison is a maximum security prison. The men in it are jailed for 4.5 years or more. Usually for long-term prisoners it's 8 years plus, and it can go up as far as 34. Men live their lives inside these high walls, and the main point of their punishment is the deprivation of their liberty. And that, for us, we take it for granted that we can wander about the place, we can go where we like, but when you're restricted to this building, when you're restricted to set areas every day and set times when you can actually mix with other human beings, that's when you realise what your liberty means to you. While I'm here in the prison, I've got to think of ways of facilitating faith for these men. It's a well-known platitude. People say it all the time, but the truth of "there but for the grace of God go I" is particularly significant. I haven't met a man in here that couldn't have been me in a moment of uncertainty, of anxiety or stress. People respond in a certain way. And as I sometimes say to the guys, and get a stick for it, maybe prison saved them. Because if they carried on in the lifestyle they led, they might not be here at all. And I'm reminded when we studied the notion of Christ as the bridge builder, building a bridge between fallen man and the Father, and building bridges in his community, bringing in the sick, the marginalised, the isolated, and showing love for these people. So I reach out in the community and I tap priests on the shoulder, and they willingly come and support me here in the prison and celebrate Mass with the men. On the more pastoral side, there are men in here who have been abandoned by their families, who have no links with the outside world and don't have anything. They stand, what they wear, what they stand up in is what they have. So I reach out to people who will help in the community. If you were destitute in the community, if you were naked and needed clothing, St Vincent de Paul is my first turn, and they willingly reach out and will supply from the thrift shop clothes that will keep a man going, socks and underwear if he needs it. There are rules in the prison that you can't bring anything else in, and that's wise enough as well. So this is St Patrick's furniture project. It's a big support for the people in the area because of it offers people the opportunity to furnish houses when they don't have a lot of money to fully furnish a house. And it puts people on their feet, but how it helps me is it's another bridge for the prisoners, because at Christmas and New Year, one of the things the project helps us with is chocolate. Selection boxes and Easter eggs. It seems ludicrous, but that simple wee act says to these men in prison, we think about you, we pray for you. Christ brought us the gospel, and the gospel is about God the Father. And when you look at the word God and the word gospel, they both begin with G-O, which says go, and that's what I do. I go to the people. I take the gospel in through this building as far as I can in every possible context and scene. And that's my role. Always at the centre of my work is the gospel. You clothed me. I was sick and you took care of me in prison, and you visited me.
Really, the deacon during the Mass is serving. Basically, that's what they're doing. Liturgically, they're serving. Yes, you read the gospel. And also you're an ordinary minister of Holy Communion.
I love being part of the liturgical part of the church, but I love everything else I do.
being able to read the Word of God to people, to proclaim it to people is brilliant. To be able to be a minister of the Eucharist, to allow them to be fed and nourished by the body and blood of God is fantastic, and it's frightening at times knowing that you're holding the body of Christ in your hands. Our RCIA, we use Robert Barnes Catholicism series. So 1 week we sit in the dining room watching a DVD. Now we'll watch a DVD, we'll say a prayer, and we'll say, right, is there anything you want to ask about the DVD? Because each DVD has a work page associated with it in the book. So the next week when they come back, we'll go through the questions that have been in the workbook. But it's quite good because it refers you to the Catechism, it refers you to the Bible, so we'll have the Bible there, we'll have the Catechism there, and we'll go to each passage and see what it refers to.
I'm in a parish. I don't have a ministry over and above that. I am at the moment involved. This is my second parish that I've been in since being ordained, and I work very closely with the parish priest. Probably the area that I have assumed some personal responsibility for is preparation for baptism, and I do a lot of baptism in the parish, so it's a lot of involvement with families, with their children, and helping them understand the nature of that very important sacrament.
There are two dimensions to my work life, you know, in relation to the diaconate. One of them is, of course, my role here as an assistant chaplain at Cardinal Newman High School. I've got a great privilege that I get the chance to speak to every single child in the school. We have a couple of sessions a week, which are the prayer and reflection sessions on a Monday and a Thursday. One homeroom after another comes down for a 25-minute slot, and we talk about aspects of faith and worship. And in some way, I think it helps to kind of counter the messages that youngsters get from the outside world that tells them that our faith is absurd. So I think that's a great privilege to spend time with the youngsters. Also, in class, I'd like to think that all my classes begin with a prayer.
Okay, boys and girls, let's get started. Name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
I teach a couple of subjects. I mainly teach hospitality, but I also taught religious education, and I enjoy teaching religious education. Perhaps the biggest element of my teaching is the witness that I provide in terms of my life as a deacon. I think that's a good example.
Baptism is probably one aspect of my ministry I do the most of. I've done a few weddings, and people connect with me because I'm married myself, I've got children, I know what it's all about. And there is that connection between the married deacon and the young married couple. I was married 43 years ago, so my wife and I got married in the church in St. Benedict's Easterhead, and we knew the nervousness of it all, and I was able to capture that and put that experience of my own into helping the two young couple that had married the past couple of years, and it helped. I feel it helped them enormously, and to marry my experiences with what they're going, hopefully, with God's love, experience themselves.
My specific ministry is hospital ministry.
Okay, bud.
And it's where I feel that I fulfil my ministry, my calling is fulfilled, because I get to meet people who are needing a lot of help, a lot of support, people who are very vulnerable, people who are hospitalised, all walks of life, all faiths and no faith, and it's very challenging and very demanding, however, it's very fulfilling.
Hello, ladies.
Hello, Francis.
Yes,
she's in
the
room 6. Would you like me to
meet him? Hi. Okay. See you later.
Bye, bye-bye.
Francis.
This is Harry, the hospital chaplain,
who's
here to see you.
Yes.
Is that okay?
How are you today, Francis?
Well,
I like about the hospital ministry, to be honest, is that for me, the role of evangelisation plays a big part in how I conduct myself. Many, many times I have met people in the hospital who have been away from the church for a number of years, in some occasions 50 years. And when you build up that relationship and that bond begins and that trust, people have actually come back to the church. Some sadly have passed away, but some have came back to the church and are now living within the Christian community. And that is very, very fulfilling.
Hello, Gavin. I'm doing all right. How are you? Nice to see you. Nice to see you. I've just popped in today to visit a few people on that and popped in to see you.
The ministry of a hospital.
Are you doing okay today, but?
Yes, it can be very demanding and very challenging, but it's very, very fulfilling. And it's a ministry that I believe God had set out for me from the beginning. And it all stemmed from 12 years ago when I lost my dad in this very hospital. And the experience that my family got from the help and support from the staff and indeed the priest who came was phenomenal. And it was where I believed the seed for hospital ministry was planted within me. So from losing my dad 12 years ago to now facilitating within a hospital environment, I believe that that was the path that was set out for me. Even though when I began my studies, I still wasn't sure if the diaconate or if indeed becoming a deacon was my will or God's will.
Since last October, really, or last August, been participating in the year of discernment. I found it very enjoyable and encouraging. Naturally enough, when we first met together as a group, we're all very kind of quiet and shy of each other, I think, total strangers. But gradually, as the years have worn on, we've become more, and I think we're all friends now.
Last year, I finally plucked up the courage and went to a discernment night, spoke to them, and decided to join the appropriate visit year. And that's been very enjoyable. Absolutely no pressure on any of us. There was 9 of us to begin with. 2 of those have pulled out, leaving 7 of us at the moment.
Anyone who thinks that perhaps they haven't got the ability or they haven't got what it takes to be a deacon, what I would like to say to you is, go with the feelings in your heart. If God has called you, He has called you for a reason. He's called you for a specific purpose. So no matter how you feel about your calling, if you believe and you feel that you have got a calling within you, please give that calling every opportunity.
I found a presence of God in my life since I began studying for the diaconate, which I didn't really have before. And the work of the diaconate has really given me a whole purpose in life now.
You know, there's been a wonderful sense of being taken into people's lives. And it's taken me into the high school, the primary schools, the care homes in the parish. I've been with different groups of people and it's been wonderful to be with them at times of celebration, also at times of sadness as well. You know, I've been with families when they're bereaved and that's a real privilege to be there at those moments. So in that sense, it's changed my life. I'm doing a lot of service that I didn't think I would be. You know, that I would be doing as a deacon, even the schools, going into the primary schools, speaking to the First Communion children in sacramental preparation, all of that has been great.
I think that's the most important aspect of it, serving the people.
It's one of the best steps I've taken. It's so rewarding. It's so fulfilling.
For many of my friends, they never used to think about matters of faith, and because they are now friendly with a deacon, all of a sudden, you know, the question of the existence of God is more of a priority than it perhaps used to be in the past.
It also made me more aware of the need to evangelise in church, to go out and to help the priests and the lay faithful to become more involved in the church.
The ministry of what I do as a deacon, again, it's all about having that balance between work, family, in ministry, and it is challenging and it is very demanding, but it is doable. And I believe that handing over to God on a daily basis is the nucleus to how I perceive my ministry and how I cope on a daily basis.
And without the support of your wife, you couldn't possibly do it. She's been very, very positive but she does it in her own way, in a background way, by her support and by her prayers.
I couldn't do this without my wife's support. I'm very, very clear on it.
When I first told my wife I was thinking about the diaconate, her response was, "What's taking so long?" She knew before I knew the road I was choosing to take.
So some people say to me, "No, it was basically part-time ministry you had." I said, "Well, no, it's not, because as I said earlier, I go to bed at night a deacon, I wake up in the morning a deacon."
I pray earnestly, and if you have any doubts, if God wants you to be a deacon, He'll direct you where to go.
Principle, favourite part of being a deacon is the involvement with the people of God and getting to know those people and getting to journey with those people on the way through this world as we all, we hope, make our way toward God again.
If you want to be a big altar boy, just be a big altar boy. If you want to be somebody that's prepared to take on Christ in the fullness of His mission, go and be a deacon.
Lord Jesus, You came to serve, not to be served. Form within us Your generous spirit.
Fill us with Your love, that we may love the Father as You love Him.
Fill us with Your compassion, that we may see our brothers and sisters as You see them.
Fill us with Your courage, that we may give our lives in service to the Church as You gave Your life for her.
Fill us with that spirit which will make us preachers of Your word.
Ministers of Your sacrifice, servants of Your bride.
Friends of the poor, and the voice of the forgotten.
Transform us through Your Holy Spirit, so that we may transform the world into
Your kingdom of justice and faith.
Amen. Amen.